Welcome to India's supersonic missile-assisted release torpedo, or their smart ASW system. I'm Aaron from subbrief.com. Let's begin. In 2016, funding for the smart ASW system comes down and money is given to DRDO. That's Defense Research and Development Organization in India. They create the new weapon systems for all the branches of the military. They're kind of the think tank for the military-industrial complex, which is very complicated in India, but these are the main guys. This missile needs to meet a few parameters. It needs to be Mach 3 capable or better. And they already have a surface-to-surface missile that exceeds that, so that's already been technically achieved by them. They want this missile to have greater than 600 kilometers range, pretty reasonable, considering the technological level that their military is at. It will have an ASW torpedo payload, though, at these Mach 3 speeds, so that's not been paired up before. It needs to be truck launcher or mobile launcher, compatible. So it can be launched from the shores and then moved around anywhere. And it also needs to be compatible with the Mark 41 VLS system that they use on the Indian ships. So it can be, operated at sea by ships and on land by these mobile launchers. This is a hybrid weapon system. They combined existing weapon systems, put them together to meet the goals of this new program, this new smart ASW system program. The first thing they did was they took their supersonic solid fuel rocket booster missile that they have now and used it for this program. They kind of modified it, made it a variant of it that we'll get into. To use this, something that they added to the missile that the current supersonic surface-to-surface missile does not have is data link. So this surface-to-surface missile can change its course and get updates on the target area in flight, in supersonic flight. The estimated flight time of this missile is about 11 minutes maximum. So they need to maintain that communication for that, at least that period of time. Because this is going to be deploying a payload into water, it can't maintain its speed the entire time. So it needs to have a velocity reduction system, an air brake, if you will. And this was one of the most difficult technical challenges of this project, was getting this velocity reduction system to work without sending the missile spiraling out of control at supersonic speeds. But they managed to achieve this. They demonstrated this in October of 2020. It's a very good engineering achievement. And then the payload is the Shahina Torpedo Advanced Lightweight. It's essentially a Mark 54 torpedo that we'll get into. So they took these systems, a current supersonic surface-to-surface missile that they already have in their inventory, a weapon system, a torpedo system that they've had for about 10 years now. They combined them together with a data link, an air brake, and they have smart ASW. So let's take a look at the missile that they use. This is a modified Shahina missile. You can see a picture of it there on the transport vehicle. It looks identical to the one that they tested in October of 2020, so I believe that this is just a modified version of this missile. Obviously, this missile is both conventional and nuclear capable. It can exceed the 600 kilometer range. This one, with its nuclear payload, with the small warheads, can go 1900 kilometers. So, well, this more than achieves the goal of getting the ASW deployable payload on target. And it has similar performance numbers in terms of the shape of the missile, the speed of the missile. It meets all those requirements, range, speed, and launch vehicle. So this was the rocket that they're starting with. Now, the payload, the origins of the payload go all the way back to 2011, even before the smart ASW system was an idea in the DRDO's agenda. They got the Mark 54 from the United States to use with their P-8 Poseidon airplanes. We sold them 32 Mark 54s, including spare parts, technical assistance with technicians on site in India. All that was approved back in June 2011. We recently renewed this contract for fewer weapons in 2019. So this is a continuing program. They're using the Mark 54 torpedo right now in India and have had it for about a decade. But what they did do was they took a couple of these apart, re-engineered them, and made their own version of the Mark 54. The Indian version of the Mark 54 torpedo is called the Shahina Torpedo Advanced Lightweight. This is a parachute-slowed, seawater-activated, 40-centimeter around lightweight torpedo. It can do about 40 knots, has a range of, in a straight line, if you want it that way, is 30 kilometers approximately. It has good autonomous search and homing. It uses the Mark 50 or a copy of the Mark 50 seeker head, which is outstanding, has great target discrimination. It can do a lot of things that aren't public, so we're not going to talk about them. It can search approximately 5 kilometers out in front of it as it does its spiraling search down. That's under really good ideal conditions, but I just want to give you an idea as to how far these torpedoes can look in really quiet conditions, you know, clear water, hard bottom, deep water. They work really good in shallow water too, by the way. So deep water is not necessarily a necessity for good conditions. As long as it's not, you know, crazy with the saline changes, with river runoffs and lots of shipping noise, it can get around and find the target. And you don't want to be in the same water column as this thing whenever it finds you, because good luck getting away from it once it identifies a target. I've run from many of these, the Mark 46 and Mark 50 version of this, in war games before, and it's terrifying, man. It's like a horror movie. You know, this thing will not stop. No matter what you chuck at it, it still comes after you. So it's a very capable torpedo. All right, so let's talk about some employment tactics that we can expect to see with the smart ASW system. Let's say we have a possible subcontact down here at time one. Okay, so they're going to try and identify that target over a period of time. And that can vary from minutes to hours to days to who knows how long. You know, it takes time to confirm a possible subcontact depending on the conditions. So at time two, let's say they did confirm, hey, hostile sub, time of war, it's time to localize and attack the submarine. Now, the way they're going to localize and attack the submarine is through a number of different methods. Some countries have offshore hydrophones. Okay, India, I don't know if they have that system or not, but if they don't, they're going to have to use aircraft or ASW assets, whether it's a ship or another submarine. They're going to get somebody out there to take a look at it. Now, the way that they'll probably do this is if they get initial contact, that contact came from some kind of platform. They'll have that contact platform stay in the area while they get a second asset, whether it's another air asset, another helicopter, whatever, on site to try and confirm and localize this. And once they have a relative track, they don't need to have its exact position, but they know that at time X it was here and at time Y it was there. You take the difference in time, you got yourself a course, bearing, and speed, range. You've got everything you need just on those two data points. They're going to combine those data points and create an aim point, okay? So at time three, we got the time three location of the sub, and we have the time three aim point ahead of the sub. And then they're going to shoot the smart ASW weapon. Now, like I said, the smart ASW weapon could take up to 11 minutes to get there. And in that 11 minutes, the battlefield can change completely. And that's where the data link comes in. This data link is great for mid-course correction, mid-course updates, you know, aim point updates, essentially. And I should point out that this isn't necessarily talking to the torpedo at all. This is just letting the missile, you know, rocket motor and its brain and its navigation system aim at the right aim point. All the torpedo cares about is when does the salt water come, and then so I can start searching for submarines, okay? The torpedo is powered down because it's powered by seawater, and it's sitting inside a rocket. It's got no power right now, so it doesn't know anything of what's going on, but the rocket does. The rocket missile, rather, technically missile, gets a mid-course correction and goes towards the time for aim point because our target submarine zigged. They turned at some point during the flight. So we have a new location of the sub, a new course, a new range, a new speed, a new aim point. While the missile's in flight, gets corrected to the new aim point and drops on the target submarine. And then once the torpedo wakes up, you know, because it's in the water now, it doesn't know any of that just happened. It has no idea. So it's going to start spiraling down in a helical, you know, spiral search that changes in three dimensions, starting shallow and going deep, looking for the submarine in about, you know, a 2 to 5 kilometer wide search. Okay. So you got a 5 kilometer wide search with another 5 kilometer wide on either side of that search looking, you know, detection cone, if you will. So you basically have a column of water that across it, 15 kilometers. If a enemy submarine is in that column of water, it's going to die by this thing. It's a very good torpedo. And the idea is to hit, you know, the submarine with this weapon And they can launch multiple of these, obviously. Yeah, so you shoot one at one aim point, and then you go an aim point to a little bit to the right, a little bit to the left, you know, a little bit deep, a little bit shallow. You shoot five total weapons in the vicinity of this thing because you don't have any other friendly submerged assets in the area. You know, this has all come from helicopter, or maybe the P-8 Poseidons have localized this. So you can shoot as many ASW weapons as you want at this thing without any threat of collateral damage to yourself. You're not going to shoot a friendly. There's no blue on blue in that scenario. And that's how they're going to employ this, I think. They won't shoot them one at a time. So this is what the effective engagement zone looks like around the country of India right now with just the land-based variant of this weapon. This is the one that they tested in October of 2020. And there's more testing to go on as well. But the most successful test in 2020 demonstrated that they're capable. They have the technology and the engineering now that they can put a weapon on this and expect it to survive the trip to the target. And the weapon, the Mark 54, essentially, is a tested, you know, proven weapon system. It's going to work once it gets safely into the water. The biggest hurdle was shooting that torpedo at supersonic speeds and slowing it down in time before it hit the water. That was really the engineering gap that they had to achieve. And they did demonstrate successfully bridging that gap in 2020. So this area around India is the coverage they have just by driving this truck up to the shoreline and shooting in the direction of a possible submarine detection. They are going to put this on ships with that Mark 41 VLS system. You know, it's going to fit in the Mark 41 VLS. Once they do that, this weapon can cover everything. Once they have a ship at sea, it'll cover the Arabian Sea easily, the Bengal or Bay of Bengal easily. They can go anywhere this weapon goes. It's going to have a huge area of effect or engagement area around the ship. Now, they haven't done that yet, but that's on the way. It's coming. So it's a great, capable tool in their toolbox, their ASW toolbox. My hat's off to India for putting this together because it's pretty brilliant to put a supersonic rapid response, you know, rocket with an ASW payload to defend your shores. Great. And they're just another ally that we have against China's aggression in this region. You know, India, in my opinion, is the anchor of our forces in the Asian Pacific Rim area to help push back a little bit against the expansionistic Chinese and just let them know that, hey, international law means something. You need to abide by it. And so by having our allies in Japan, the Philippines, Australia, Vietnam, and China, in India, we can help push back a little bit against China in a peacetime, peaceful way by developing systems like this. I think it's a big part in our attempt to counterbalance China's expansion. All right, that's it. My name's Aaron. I own the subbrief.com. Check it out over there. If you are interested in, you know, bringing me over for a talk, whether it's on Zoom or talk to your team of people of, you know, whatever you want to have me do with you, please contact me at aaron@subbrief.com. I've got time now through the summer, and I'll be more than happy to make the trip out to wherever you may be. And we'll work it out via email. All right. Thanks for watching, everybody. Bye.